You know, I joined the Marine Corps at the age of 17 in the summer before my senior year. My father had a co-sign with me, like I was a teenager buying a car with that credit. I wasn't old enough to legally be responsible for that decision. September 11th happened a month and a half before I went to boot camp. And I think like many people that joined either before and obviously after, left with kind of a sense of duty and this idea that we were going to right a national wrong. And, you know, I was, amongst a generation of vets that fell for that reasoning, kind of hook, line, and sinker. And, you know, I think that there's a lot of things that makes that easy, but, growing up, now retrospectively looking at a culture that really, you know, holds militarism and violence and war making, kind of up in this pedestal, looking back, that made my decision a whole lot easier than it would have been otherwise. So I'm part of the generation of 2.5 million veterans that have served after 9/11 in both Afghanistan and Iraq. 2.5 years after joining, after going to boot camp, I found myself deployed into a country that I knew next to nothing about, for reasons that at the time I could begin to wrap my head around as a young person. I deployed to Iraq in 2004, and I had 5 months back in the States, and I went right back out again in 2005. Often members of Iraq Veterans Against the War are asked, what was the moment? What was the kind of crystallizing moment that put you in a position to really question the war? And I think often unsatisfactorily, I answer and other folks answer that there wasn't necessarily one particular moment. There was kind of this gradual process, like a dawning realization that all of the professed reasons for us being there were PR slogans, winning the hearts and minds. And the reality on the ground was in fact, the opposite, that what we were doing was making things worse. If I had to pin down an exact moment, it had to be when I was guarding Iraqi laborers that were coming onto our base, that were quote-unquote friendlies, and they were doing work like filling sandbags and stacking them. And, in the process of getting to know them, I was fortunately able to ask the translator, what are folks looking for? What has been your interaction? Time and time again, I heard things like, we just want water, we want electricity, we want a sense of safety. And in fact, since we had invaded, all of those things had diminished dramatically. And I think that really started to put me on a path of questioning the war. Fortunately, I served with another veteran who brought me into IVAW later down the road, who was much more politically progressed or evolved in her analysis. And I think one of the things that we talked about was the dehumanization that was kind of inherent in I don't know that we're as critical about dehumanization for ourselves, but dehumanization of the folks inside of Iraq. Terms like Haji were used, and something that Joyce had told me was that's no different from terms that Vietnam vets use for the Vietnamese, using words like "gook," and that really opened my eyes a bit. And I think that a lot of folks dealt with that. And these were common ways of dehumanizing the enemy. But not just the enemy, whatever that is defined as, but dehumanizing an entire people and allowing folks to do things and have a real kind of sense of ambiguity in terms of what rules of engagement look like. So, in terms of the generation that I come from, this 2.5 million veterans, there's a few hallmarks that distinguish us from, our brothers and sisters from Vietnam and generations before that. One of the main distinctions is multiple deployments. We're all volunteer military. We have been in war for 10 years now, and there's not that many of us. There's less than half of 1% of the American population is in the reserves in the active duty military. What that means is that the military has been forced to constantly redeploy troops. And what we also know is that the effects of constant redeployment compound the trauma that folks receive. So in terms of PTSD, some of the more recent studies see that 20 to 50% of folks that have deployed to Iraq or Afghanistan have been affected by PTSD. 20 to 40% of soldiers leaving on repeated deployments report symptoms of past concussive injuries, injuries like traumatic brain injury. Military sexual trauma affects 1 in 3 women. We know that's an underreported figure, and even more so for male veterans that are also affected by that for reasons of stigma. Now, the person that I referred to earlier, Joyce, who I questioned the war together with, and I were on the same forward operating base, and we were both guarding Iraqis and both kind of questioning things at the same time. And when we came back home from deployments, we were both erratic and emotionally unstable, and we didn't realize why. We weren't given the tools to understand what that could be. And after the fact, I think that we both were taking risks and in positions where we didn't, we felt changed, but we didn't have the language to articulate why we were. Years later, Joyce admitted to me that she had been that statistic. She had been one out of the 3 women that had been raped in the military. And she explained that how difficult it would have been to call her, her perpetrator to task inside of a culture that was so stigmatized, and that the knee-jerk reaction was to rape blame. Joyce was at the press conference and the launch of this initiative on Monday, and she said a lot of really powerful things. And one of the things that she related was her experience coming out of the military and realizing that this was something that had happened to her, and a knowledge that she needed to claim that through the VA process. After going through multiple mental health professionals and telling her story, she said, and this is a quote, "After sharing the most personal and painful details of my life, I heard nothing from the VA for over a year. It took over two years before I received a letter stating that my claim was denied because, amongst other things, I had invited my rapist into my tent." That's not an uncommon story, unfortunately. And this link between stigmatization in the military and stigmatization in the VA is unfortunately all too common. And lack of care in the military and lack of care in the VA. One of the things that, so Iraq Veterans Against the War has been around since 2004. We started out as a speakers bureau, and over time have evolved to understand that speaking out alone was not going to change the conditions that we're seeing. In 2008, we had Winter Soldier, which was dozens of veterans attesting to their experiences with a virtual media blackout in terms of mainstream press. That set us on a path to really look at what concrete change we had made in service members' lives, which we understood that we hadn't at that point. Not anything that we could quantify. And that put us into a really self-reflective phase where we decided it was time to organize, to get our community together, to build collective power, to push on the centers of that were kind of perpetrating these things. So over a course of time, in 2011, we decided to go down to Fort Hood, Texas. Fort Hood is the biggest base in the country. In 2010, it had the highest suicide rate of any base in the country. It had also just witnessed the massacre of 13 soldiers by an Army psychologist. It also had the highest rates of redeployment, which we knew from our own community was part of the issue that we were looking at. So we did an outreach process, and we did the testimonial collection this last year, and we reached out to veterans and active duty service members in the area to figure out, you know, what are people experiencing. And what we found was service members in a very, very real sense are being treated as equipment. I will pretend this is anything new, but by being a volunteer military and bearing the burden of two wars, you know, it's understood that once, you know, as equipment, and that's no longer useful to the military effort, one of two things was starting to happen. So those service members that were continuing to be deployed were essentially wrung out for all of their use. So one person that I talked to had breakdown in cartilage in his chest, and he understood that when he, you know, tried to get healthcare for that, he was basically told, "We're sending you out anyway." Less than six months later, he was airlifted out of the war zone because he had such physical damage. You know, that's a visible wound of war as opposed to the invisible wounds of war that we really advocated around. The other kind of way of dealing with this was kicking people out for disciplinary issues. So under the auspices of a pre-existing condition like personality disorder or adjustment disorder, of which 31,000 cases have been documented and are now being called for in Congress to be reviewed, people were kicked out, and also you had folks that were receiving disciplinary infractions around drugs and alcohol with absolutely no consideration of the service member's history around deployments. You know, often these are folks that have no disciplinary problems at all, and now they're suddenly, you know, showing the symptoms of alcoholism. And so one of the things that we're really finding is that the military is great at treating the symptoms, but not the root causes of these traumas. And that the military would rather kick someone out and not have to pay for the trauma over an extended period of time than actually admit that they were a part of the cause for that. You know, I think that this really led us to isolate and determine that redeployments were an issue, along with, as the military is drawing down, kicking people out under these various things that I've already outlined. And the last thing that I'll touch on quickly is what's happening in the VA. The amount of the VA claims backlog has doubled from 450,000 to 900,000 within a year. We have 32,000 troops that are going to be withdrawing from Afghanistan, and a whole, you know, population of veterans. You know, as it is right now, you know, folks are waiting a year plus on their benefits claims. But are, you know, this new growing population is going to only make it that much worse. The VA decided recently, under the reasoning that we're going to that. For budgetary reasons, have decided to cancel a committed to linking of the Department of Defense and the VA's medical health records keeping system. They spent 4 years and $1 billion on it, and they're canceling it and improving the systems that already haven't been working. It's clear to me and clear to folks in my community that the military has no interest in paying for the costs of war. Amongst service members, amongst veterans. I don't have a lot of time yet, but I do want to spend a little bit of time just to mention that I think we understand that solidarity is an important piece to the work that we do, that we understand the folks inside of Iraq and Afghanistan are the most impacted, and that if we're not working with them and helping visibilize the costs of war in very real ways for a population that realistically does not know what's happening in Iraq or Afghanistan, and that kind of story is not told. I read something recently that I felt like was very illustrative of that huge kind of gap in understanding. And the author called it strategic narcissism. Mark Lynch, who's an expert on Arab public opinion in George Washington University, mentioned that, reflected on the retrospectives that have been written around the 10th anniversary of the Iraq War. So the New Republic ran commentaries by 8 writers, none of them Iraqi. Mm-hmm. Foreign Affairs featured 25 contributors, none Iraqi. Mm-hmm. New York Times did slightly better, 1 Iraqi out of 6 commentators. Foreign Policy, in cooperation with Rand Corporation, featured 20% participants in a lengthy discussion on lessons learned from Iraq. Not a single one was from Iraq. I think that's one symptom of a much larger problem, that we have not been willing to assess the human costs of war inside of Iraq, but also for our veterans community. Thank you.